Well, hey, good morning. Welcome to all of our Highlanders, to all of our campuses. Excited to be with you today. We're going to continue in our series that we started last week called Signal Strength. We're talking about boosting our relationships. Nathan mentioned to you, I'm going to be talking about marriage, but listen, I don't want you, you may not be here and you're going, man, that's not me. I probably showed up the wrong Sunday. But the reality is what I talk about today is certainly applicable to a number of other relationships, but I am going to hone in this day on marriage. Well, when I started thinking about relationships, there were two that came to my mind. I think about the influence that both my granddads had in my life. Men that I loved and men that I knew loved me. One of which was that guy who, whenever we had a family gathering, he was the life of the party. He really was. Absolutely loved times for us to get together. But my granddad, too, you got to know this about him. If he felt like the water was kind of stagnant and stale, he didn't mind to stir things up a little bit, okay? And that's just kind of the way that he worked. And so I can remember hearing the story years and years ago. My grandmother, she worked the majority of her life at a dry cleaners out in Bluefield, West Virginia. Bluefield campus, great to know that you guys are with us this morning. But those guys, my grandmother, she worked there, and the last thing that somebody that works at a dry cleaner wants to do is go home and work on their own laundry, right? I mean, it's the last thing that you want to do. And so she's there, and she is taking care of the laundry of the family, and she's ironing, but now she's not using the irons like we have today. She's got like the real iron, like it's a slab of iron that you drop down onto a hot plate, heats it up, you pull it off, and then you just start. So she's, I mean, it's no fun. And my granddad, though, this is not enough action for him. And so he starts picking. He starts kind of stirring the water a little bit. She didn't want anything to do with it. She said, look, I've got something that I'm trying to get done. And his name was Dallas. She would say, Dallas, you better stop. Fair warning, I'm telling you better stop. Well, he would not pay attention, right? And he just kept stirring the water, kept picking a little bit, till finally she raised up the iron. She said, Dallas, are you listening to me? I will stick you with this iron if you don't pay attention to what I'm telling you. Stop picking at me. To which then he steps up, grabs the top of his shirt, and this rips it open. Brrr! I mean, buttons are flying everywhere. Bare chest is now sticking. And he never saw it coming, but brother, she branded him. Ka-choosh! Right there. You know, and I think, you didn't mess with Granny, I'll just tell you, right? But I feel like life is filled with those moments we probably should have seen coming, but we didn't see coming. And that's the title of this morning's message is We Never Saw It Coming. We put together a real short clip. It's a video full of life circumstances, some of which we hope that you'll see a little bit of comedic relief in. But check out this video called Never Saw It Coming. Well, they never saw any of those moments coming. Maybe they should have, because come they did at any rate, right? So this morning I'm going to focus on the marriage relationship. I'm going to talk about some things that are in our marriage that you would think you would be able to see, that you would see the posing threat that they that they present to our marriage, but sometimes we don't see until afterwards. I find that most failed marriages don't result because of a sudden blowout. It happens because a slow leak has gone on for a long time and it just went undetected. And then suddenly somebody looks up and goes, "What just happened?" Well, it didn't just happen. It was something that happened over a long period of time. We just failed to pay any attention. And so it felt like, I never saw this coming. So this morning I'm going to look at of one simple truth. I want you to write this down at the top of your outline. It's this. It's about marriage. Marriage is a big thing, but it's won or lost in the small things. It is a big thing. It's consummated on one day, but you see, it's got to be worked at. It's got to be watched over because it's won or lost in the small things. You can never arrive at that place where you begin to think, "Hey, we've been together long enough. Can't we just put this relationship on cruise control?" That's the temptation, that somehow you and I can get to a place of such comfort that we feel like we don't have to give it any energy or we don't have to work at it necessarily anymore. Our text this morning comes from an Old Testament book called the Song of Solomon. So I want to give you a little bit of background. It's kind of a love poem. It is filled with imagery and poetic voice. It is the story of, it's kind of the love story between Solomon and a young Shulamite woman who are just, they are goo-goo over each other. And when I say that the lines are filled with imagery, it's kind of a banter back and forth. "Well, I love you this much." "No, I love you more. I love you this much." You know, and they're just kind of going back and forth in description of their love for each other. It sounds a little bit like, "Hey, your love is better than wine." And then she looks at me, "Yeah, but your eyes are like doves." Or, "I feel like I'm lovesick for you." Or, "You're my honeysuckle. I'm your honeybee." Actually, that was Blake Shelton. I was just making sure y'all were paying attention. Okay? And so, but you get the idea. It is filled with imagery. The whole book is. And it's just one line after another until you've reached our focus verse this morning. It's Solomon chapter 2, verse 15. I want you to read this along with me. And this is what she tells him, because it's a sudden shift. In this banter of love, all of a sudden she issues this warning. She says, "Solomon, I want you to catch the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vineyard, because our vineyard is in blossom." And so here's what I want us to do in regards to this verse. You kind of see it? Catch the foxes, those little foxes that will spoil the vineyard. Our vineyard is in blossom. Point number one on your outline is this. You got to get the picture. If this book is filled with imagery and poetry, then sometimes we got to take a little bit of time to make sure we understand what's being conveyed. This passage is not about little foxes and grapes, okay? Just so that you know. So we want to get the picture. What is it about? Two things that you got to get right away, and it's pretty simple. The vineyard is a picture of marriage. The vineyard is a picture of marriage. And so when she says, "I want you to get these foxes out of the vineyard," she's saying, "I want you to protect what is sacred to us." She says something about the vineyard. The vineyard is in blossom. I want to just say this, because some of you are right now, you're in a great place, and you would say, "Hey, Craig, I think we're in a, you know, we seem to be fine right now." Well, I just want you to know that Solomon and the young Shulamite, they were in a great place too. The relationship looked healthy, but she also recognized it's in those moments that you're still vulnerable. So often we wait until the marriage needs to be rushed into the OR and somebody is saying, "Please save us. Please keep us alive." And so if you're here today and you're married, I don't care if you're in great times or you're in total disarray, give ear to what God wants to share with you this morning. The vineyard represents the marriage. The second thing, the foxes, they represent threats that are posed to the marriage. Threats that are posed to the marriage. This is anyone, anything that wants to steal the joy that belongs to the two of you alone. So this verse really is a warning. It's a warning because Point number two on your outline is this: little foxes can cause big problems. Little foxes, I mean, they're just little bitty furry creatures, but they can wreak havoc if they go unnoticed. In fact, the Shulamite looks to Solomon and says, they will spoil the vineyard. I'm going to share with you just four that I find just over and over again in our times of counseling with a number of couples who have gone through some difficult seasons. Four simple foxes that I trust will be an alarm in our own hearts and in our minds as well. Now, I would just say this. I'm always very humbled to teach on marriage relationship. Melinda, my wife, and I, we've been married for close to 28 years now. And I look back and I just realize, but by the grace of God, have we been able to experience survival through those times and times of thriving. And so today, I humbly stand before you, not as one who feels like he's got it all together, but one who has to chase these little foxes out of his vineyard too. Okay? Here's the first one. It's the fox of inattention. The fox of inattention. Now, I want you to think about how your relationship started off. When we begin to appeal to each other, we will go to whatever length or whatever pursuit is necessary in order to reveal to the other person, I can't spend enough time with you. I love being with you. I love the way you look, the way you smell, just the way I feel when I'm around you. And so sometimes we could have been on the phone with each other, not said a word for 10 minutes. I just want to hear you breathe, right? I mean, this is crazy, but that's the level of pursuit. And then we get married. And once we get married, the pursuit comes to an end. Because for a lot of men, the hunt's over, you know? And suddenly, we have moved into a position where we don't yield the same level of attention. Suddenly, we find ourselves taking the other for granted. Why? Because in our minds, we think this: we already know all there is to know about each other, right? I can finish her sentence, she can finish my sentences. And we just feel like there's such a place of awareness that we move into complacency instead of yielding to each other a continued energy. It's a very unhealthy place for us to be. We become very vulnerable when our passion is replaced by apathy. Some of you, I know, love gardening. You'll take root into this passage, Proverbs 24, verses 30 to 34. I want you to notice what Solomon, who writes Proverbs as well, notice what he says. I passed by the field of a sluggard. What is a sluggard? A lazy man. A man who knows what needs to be done but refuses to yield the work that is necessary to be done. I passed by the field of a sluggard. By the vineyard. Ah, we were talking about vineyards today. By the vineyard of a man lacking sense. And behold, it was all, notice the condition of the vineyard. It's all overgrown with thorns. It didn't used to be, but it is now. The ground was covered with nettles, and its stone wall was broken down. Then I saw and I considered it. I looked and received instruction. What Solomon's saying is, I wondered, how did that vineyard go from what I used to know it to be to what it is now? And then this is what he concludes. I want you to notice, it's a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and then poverty will come upon you like a robber. What did he say? You know how inattention creeps in? And this is the reason I feel like this fox is so sneaky. This fox can, because it doesn't show up overnight. You don't go to bed one night full of attention, wake up the next day and have no attention. No, it's just like this verse. It's little by little by little. It's a little of the folding of the hands. It's taking a little rest. It's taking a little time away from the energy that's necessary for each other. And then suddenly somebody looks up and says, we've been robbed. Everything that we had. And it's like it happened overnight, but did it? It didn't happen overnight. It happened little by little by little. You know, is there a chance that that fox is running around in your relationship right now because you started off so well? or you've had seasons where you've really yielded energy to each other, but lately it just feels like you're roommates. You're sharing a roof. You've got, he's got his schedule, she's got her schedule, and we just kind of, we meet underneath the same roof at night, but we don't really share life together anymore. It's a dangerous place to be when that fox is running around and we don't yield attention to each other. Many couples are surprised at how quickly it feels like damage has been done, but it's only after the fact that we look back and go, you know, we were in danger for a long time. We just didn't pay any attention to the fox running around. And I feel bad that we didn't. In fact, I often find that usually one spouse opens to this need. They see the fox of inattention before the other spouse. And they begin to conclude, we're not okay. In fact, I know we're not okay. And I want to protect what I see, and I'm trying to get your attention, but you're not yielding any attention. You're just kind of continuing on as though we're okay. We're not okay. It reminds me, and they begin to sound an alarm, and it's like it's going off. They're trying to convey with everything that's in them, we're not okay, but there is a spouse who's like, can I hear the alarm? It reminds me of the lyrics of a song. I love this group called The Lumineers, and they sing a song called Stubborn Love. In the midst of that song, the lyrics say this: the opposite of love is indifference. We just begin to conclude, do you still care? And then it goes on and says, so pay attention now. I'm standing on your porch. I'm screaming out, and I won't leave until you come downstairs. And I know some of you are right now, you're in the same situation. You feel like, Craig, I can't continue to scream out. What am I going to do? And maybe it is today that God begins to open both your eyes to the fox of inattention. Because if you don't recognize that you both need to give energy, you both need to give focus to the Lord and to each other, you're going to find that eventually somebody grows weary of screaming out loud. They grow weary of trying to sound the alarm. And so maybe it's today that God finally grips your attention. Pay attention. Because that little fox can do a lot of damage in your relationship. When is the last time that you carved out a little bit of time? I know that you're busy. I know that you've got a lot going on. I know that you feel like you got a lot of responsibility. But when's the last time that you carved out time for your spouse? And in the midst of all of our crazy schedules, in the midst of this ever-present technology where we have one screen after another in front of us, whether it's a phone screen, a TV screen, or a laptop screen, when's the last time that you yielded your eyes and your ears to your spouse? When's the last time that you gave that kind of attention, that you sat down and talked with each other? Because if you don't do that now, then I promise you the inattention is going to wreak havoc in your vineyard or in your marriage. Well, let's move on to the second fox. That fox of inattention nails so many of us because as time travels on, he slips in. But there is the fox of people. The fox of people. I want to go over three specific groups. Here's the first group of people. It's little people. Little people. What do I mean by that? I mean your children. Your children. And I know some of you are thinking, but Craig, how can our children begin to serve as a fox in the marriage? You said they were threats. Well, children are gifts, no doubt. Psalm 127 says that children are a gift from God. And so here's where they can become threats. There is a priority system in which God has established for our lives. That you and I are to love God first, and then you and I are called to love our spouse. Let a man leave his mother and father, cleave unto his wife, that is, hold fast unto her. She is to receive the second priority. He is to receive the second priority in your life. when those children begin to supersede that, things get all out of whack, all out of whack. And it happens all the time because we have a desire somehow for our children to reach a new place, to have all the things that we weren't able to experience. But you turned out all right with exactly what you did experience, right? And I look at that and I think, hey, you've got to remember, you and I have to remember this simple truth. Eventually, they're leaving and you're staying. I know I lost some of you because you're thinking, when are they leaving? When exactly is that day that they're heading out? But the reality is they will. One day they're going to leave. When's the last time you had a conversation with your spouse that wasn't about the children? Had nothing to do with them. But usually it captures our attention so much that they begin to have a priority over the other spouse. And that takes its toll. Little people who are a blessing from God can actually serve as a fox inside the vineyard. Then secondly, there's big people. Big people can too. What do I mean by big people? I'm talking about intruders. People who have come into the marriage that don't belong inside the marriage. If I went back to the original verse, remember she said, Solomon, I want you to get those foxes out of the vineyard. Every vineyard had a boundary around it. It was a stone wall. And that stone wall was meant to keep the little critters, those foxes, out. And the foxes would always look for a compromise in the boundary. Your marriage needs a healthy boundary. It needs an established boundary. What do I mean by that? Men, I don't know where you're at right now, but look at me. Eyeball to eyeball. I wish I had time to get every one of you. Don't you have a conversation with a woman that you should only have with your wife, because that's outside the boundaries of what is healthy for your marriage. And then what you meant to take place and what you never meant to take place will be completely switched. And women, if I could look at you today, I would look at every one of you and I would say, don't you have a conversation with a man that you would not have with your husband standing right beside you? Why? Because it's a clear indication that I am traveling outside the boundaries, or somebody who is outside the boundaries is traveling into a place that they do not belong. Don't be naive. You're playing a game that is so dangerous. I would tell you the distance between an emotional connection and a physical affair is a real, real short step, brother. And some of you don't, you're playing a game. You're being naive. You think that there's no way that this will lead. It does. And every single time I have to sit down in an office and I hear somebody tell me, I never meant for this to happen. I never saw this happening. It always starts because there was a breach. There was a breach in the boundary. Somebody didn't recognize how important it was to protect the boundary of the marriage. So there's little people, there's big people, and then third, I want to share with you this, there's fantasy people too. Fantasy people. What do I mean by that? I want to address what has really become an issue in a lot of marriages. It's pornography. Pornography. Somehow we have dismissed this fox as harmless because so many people have said, this doesn't hurt anybody. This is just me and, you know, somebody that's not real. Well, I would say this, that is a lie. That is such a lie, because the moment that we allow this little fox to work into the marriage or in the vineyard, we have invited the worst of all people. They're not real. It's a recipe for unrealistic, unattainable expectations. You've brought somebody in that your spouse feels like they will never measure up to. It is a fantasy world. And you've created an insatiable appetite for physical intimacy that can never exist inside your relationship. It is so unhealthy. And yet we've excused it as not dangerous. Nothing could be further from the truth. Nothing could be further from the truth. So I would tell you, when you look at those, people, if you see any of them inside of the boundaries that belong to you and your spouse, this is not a political statement, but I would say, build a wall, brother. And build it now. And build it high, build it thick, because there are some people that do not belong behind your wall. And there are some people that if they're there now, you need to get them out. You need to get them out. Okay? And reestablish it the way that God wants you to. Well, let's move on to the third fox this morning. It's the fox of keeping up with the Joneses. Keeping up with the Joneses. Now, if you happen to be a Jones here this morning, this is not personal. But I will say, you have put a lot of pressure on the rest of us, right? We just feel like we're supposed to keep up with it, you know? And it's a comparison trap. We enter into this race of I'm going to do it all. And that somehow if I'm able to do it all, I'm going to be happy. In fact, that concept of we're going to do it all, it influences so much of what we do in the dynamics of our marriage and in our families. I begin to conclude this. Our kids have to do that. Why do our kids have to do that? Because the Joneses' kids did that. Or we've got to go on vacation there. Why do we have to go on vacation there? Because the Joneses went there last year. They put their pictures on social media. It just blew up. We have got to go to vacation there so that we can keep up with the Joneses. And then I look and I think, well, sometimes I hear, we've got to move to that neighborhood. Why do we have to move to that neighborhood? I like the house that we got. Yeah, but the Joneses live in that neighborhood. All the Joneses live there. And so there is it's just a real unhealthy race of trying to do it all. And I would say if you think that there's not a cost associated to running the race of doing it all, you're wrong. You're wrong. Because there's a high price to pay. I think about people who have tried to do it all, what has happened to their finances? They've gotten all out of whack. Why? They were trying to keep up with people they don't even like, to buy stuff they don't even need. But somehow I felt like there was I had to do that because it allowed me in public perception to look as though I'm keeping up with the Joneses. Or I think about my schedule, as crazy it is. It will only get crazier when you're trying to keep up with the Joneses. You will pass yourself going down the interstate. Your minivan will see your own minivan going the other way. You're thinking, what is going on? It is because you're trying to keep up with somebody, to keep up a schedule that is unsustainable. And it's crazy at times. Now, Jesus tells the story of planting a seed on different types of soil. And he tells that story to help us examine our relationship with God. This morning, I'm examining the relationship of marriage. It's a different relationship, but the principle still remains. Look with me at Luke 8, verse 14. As for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and the riches and the pleasures of life, and the fruit never matures. I think what happens to us when we are chasing after the Joneses, trying to keep up with what the world says is important, it chokes our marriage. It chokes the marriage relationship. I begin to wonder, when are we going to learn contentment? When will I learn to love the life that God has given me? And when I say the life that he has given me, I'm talking about, when will I learn to be content to love the things, what he has given me, and who he has given me to do life with? Are you content there? Right? If not, then I think that this is a fox that can do a lot of damage and wreak a lot of havoc in your marriage. And then number four, let me close with this one. Here is fox number four. It's keeping score. Keeping score. What do I mean by that? It's a dangerous little fox because for a lot of us, we never really learn how to handle the hurts and the wounds that we receive from each other. And I just want to remind you, marriage is made up of two sinful people. Two sinful people, not two perfect people. And so the probability that you're going to hurt one another, it's not just probable, it's inevitable, right? And so if it's inevitable, what will we do with the hurts and the wounds that we inflict on each other? Well, for a lot of couples, they get stuck in the past. They're not able to live in the present. They've stopped holding hands because now they're holding grudges. And there was a time in which they wrote love letters to each other, but now they're writing rap sheets. Why? Because they're trying to remind the other, I will never let you forget not one hurt, not one wound, not one failure. I will always remind you of those things. So could I just encourage you to think about this? If a person has handled their hurt or their wound, if they've handled that in a biblical way, what is that? If they have confessed that thing to you and they've issued the apology, for you to hold on to the grudge, for you to hold on to the wound, for you to hold on to the past, that's a foul. That's a foul. And I just want to encourage you to understand that there's a lot of couples that struggle right here because that fox of holding a grudge, of keeping score, never allows the freedom to move forward. That could be where you're at today. And you didn't even see it. You didn't recognize it. But somebody feels like it's been one foul after another. How does God want us to love one another? 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 and 5. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable. And I want you to circle this word. It is not resentful. What does the word resentful mean? When he says love's not resent, it means that it does not count the wrongs. It doesn't keep score. It doesn't keep a record of wins and losses. When a person feels, listen, because you might be really struggling here, and I want to be honest with you. When a person feels that forgiveness is unattainable, when they feel like they will forever live underneath the baggage of their failures, there's never a chance of eluding, they will eventually walk away. They'll eventually walk away. They will eventually detach. They may be there physically, but they're not there emotionally. They will withdraw. Why? Because you can't continue to live with the constant reminder of your failure hanging over your head. Either way, I want you to understand that this fox can destroy a marriage. And I know it seems difficult to think, but I want you to consider how God has forgiven us. What has God done with your sin? Do you know that God doesn't sit there and hold your failures over your head? Hey, Craig, remember this failure? Oh, Craig, let me remind you tomorrow. You remember this failure? Do you remember when you disappointed me this time? God doesn't do that at all. In fact, if I'm willing to confess those things to him, he's willing to cleanse me. And this is what I know about my sin that has been confessed. Look with me at Psalm 103, verses 11 and 12. The scripture says this, and it's all about the way that God handles our confessed sin. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west. How far is that? Brother, it keeps on going. There's no end to the separation. So far does he remove our transgressions from us. God's not holding it over my head. He's forgiven me. He's canceled the debt. All of that was handled by Christ on the cross. And it was handled in the moment of confession. God, forgive me. Now, there have been times when somebody, your spouse, has said, I was wrong. Please forgive me. It'll hold the past over them. It's a slippery slope. You'll want to hold it over them in thinking that you're going to control them, but you'll run them off. You'll run them off without question. To forgive means you allow them to heal. Well, I'm basically done this morning, and this is what I want to share with you. Point number three. I want to encourage you to take action today. Take action today. Song of Solomon 2:15, it's where we began this morning. The Shulamite looked at Solomon and she said this, catch the foxes. I want you to circle the word catch. Catch the foxes. Why? Because it is a word that expresses urgency. The word catch means this. I want you to lay hands on them now. Quickly seize them. Don't let another day go by without addressing this. I know that some of you are thinking, well, Craig, you know, I think eventually when things are, you know, if we get into some tumultuous times, we'll deal with those foxes. Can I remind you, while things were great, she looked at Solomon and said, right now, would you catch the foxes? Right now. Don't allow those foxes to remain in the vineyard. And I'm thinking three things. First is this. Is it time for you to check in? Today. Is today the time for you to sit down, put the kids wherever they got to go? Tell them to go play out in the road, whatever they got to do. But you need to sit down with them, with your spouse, and just, it's time to check in. Hey, the things that we heard at worship today, are there some foxes running around in our vineyard? Are there some threats to the marriage that we're pretending like we don't see, but we both do see? And I know that that may be uncomfortable, but I'm telling you, brother, I have a heart, we have a heart that you would have a healthy marriage. Would you take the time today just to check in and say, today I want to know, how are you? I want to yield you my attention. My eyes and my ears, they are focused on you. I want to know how we are from your perspective. Secondly, I think it's a great time for you to consider signing up for what is going to be a great marriage conference right here in this place Friday and Saturday. It's the XO Marriage Conference. Lindsay will come out and tell you all about it. And then third, I would say this. How about starting with Jesus? Starting with Jesus. Don't resort to Jesus, but I want to encourage you to start with him. Would you do that? You know, if for today, I would say God may have opened your eyes to have seen that there's been a bunch of little foxes running around. I didn't realize they were causing so much damage. But God's opened your eyes to see some things that need to be corrected. What do you do? Matthew 11, I'm closing with this. Matthew 11, 28. Jesus says this, come to me. Come to me is what he says. I'm not asking you to remain where you are. He's saying, I want you to come to me. The world doesn't have the answers that you're looking for. No worldly counselor. He says specifically, you don't possess all that is necessary to catch those foxes. There's some blind spots that you don't see. There's some things that you're not going to be able to catch. And yet Jesus looks and says, come to me. All of you who are weary and heavy laden. And then he says something that I long for in my own merit. I'll give you rest. I'll give you rest. You know, I just want to think about where you're at right now in your marriage. Is it weary and heavy laden? What Jesus says is, I want to give you rest. I want you to find a place of peace that the world will never yield to you, but you can find it in me. He goes on, he says, take my yoke upon you, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. He says, I want you to learn from me. We're going to work together. There's some things in your marriage that you're not going to be able to fix on your own, but if we work together, take my yoke upon you, we can work on this together. And if we do that, you're going to get to a better place. I don't know how God has spoken to you this morning, but I hope and trust that if he's opened your eyes to some things in your marriage, that you're willing to seek him and to take action together. Would you join me in a time of prayer right now? I want to pray over our marriages. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the day that you have given to us. I thank you for a love that has awakened us from death to life. I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to join in life for so many that are here today, just to be able to do life together as husband and wife. And I know there are a lot of other relationships that are represented here in this room. I do. And Lord, the repair or the threats that need to be addressed in whatever capacity, Lord, I pray that you'll be at work there. But just today, Lord, you really laid upon my heart to focus on the relationship of marriage. And so I pray for husbands and wives today. I lift them up to you. And there are some things that we can't see, we would never see, maybe we didn't even want to see. But the reality is there's some foxes that have been running around and they have done a lot of damage. Lord, you tell us that if we would come to you, Lord, you begin to create a place of healing that we cannot find in and of ourselves. And so today, I just pray that just one by one, marriage by marriage, Lord, that there would be a willingness in our hearts to turn to you, to surrender to you, that pride would be squelched, and in humility, we would desire your power to be at work in our marriage. We would desire to love one another the way that you have loved us, to forgive one another the way that you have forgiven us. Father, I pray that in the marriages represented here today, when a lost world that does not know you, when they look upon those marriages, may they catch a glimpse of who you are. May they look and may they see a love that looks so different than what the world does and the way the world loves. And may they have a thirst, a desire for you in their own lives, in their own marriages. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.